It wasn't very long ago that most of us drank very little wine in Australia. Since then, there's been a revolution in our attitude to food and wine. Restaurants have sprung up everywhere, and we eat out more than we've ever done before. And wine has changed from being a once-in-a-while drink to become a part of everyday life. Almost each day, we see new wine labels and new styles of wine. They're all there to enjoy. The more we know about wine, the more we can enjoy it. Wine is an alcoholic beverage made by fermenting the juice of grapes. There are about 50 different varieties of grapes used for making wine in Australia. When the grapes are ripe, sometime between the end of January and May, they're picked and then taken to the winery for crushing. As the grapes are crushed, they're separated from their stalks. The crushed grape berries, the juice, pulp and skin and seeds, are called must by the winemaker. If the grapes are red, the must is usually pumped straight into fermenting tanks. If the grapes are white, the juice is separated from the skins and seeds soon after crushing because the skins and seeds used in a red wine to give it character can take away from a white's freshness and delicacy. Fermentation is started in the grape juice by adding what's known as a starter yeast. Yeasts are living microorganisms that grow and multiply rapidly as they live off the crushed grapes. As the yeasts multiply, they produce chemical substances known as enzymes. The enzymes act on the sugar in the grape juice and convert it into almost equal parts of carbon dioxide gas and alcohol. The gas goes off into the air, and what's left is wine. The new wine is run off. During fermentation, the skins and seeds and the residue of the yeast cells sink to the bottom of the fermenting tank. This solid matter that is left contains a lot of wine and is pressed to extract the wine left in it. Sometimes the pressings are used separately, but mostly they're added to the free-run wine because the tannin extracted from the skins adds character and flavor. And if it's red, the skins add more color.
Sherry, like these casks over on your left, then the wine is left there for a considerable time.
When wine's first made, it's usually left to age, to soften and lose its yeasty character. How long it ages depends on the type of wine. But there is a time in a wine's life when it'll be at its best. With aging, subtle chemical changes soften the wine and bring out its character. A subtle blend of its inheritance from the soil, its district, and its grape variety. Reds are aged much longer than whites, up to 2 years in the cask, so that the wood can impart flavor into the wine. The best wood to give this flavor is oak. White wines are mostly aged in the bottle. If they're aged in the cask, it's for a comparatively short time before they're bottled, so they keep their freshness and crispness. Wine is aged away from light, at a constant temperature, without being disturbed. The aging of wine is a slow and gentle process. To enjoy. It relaxes us. It gives us a sense of well-being, and it breaks down social barriers. Drinking and eating and enjoyment are the most natural pleasures in the world. For most of us, our introduction to wine comes as a celebration. Wine's wonderful then, but there are many other times that we can enjoy wine. Basically, there are four different kinds of wine. Wines we drink before a meal. Wines we drink with a meal. Wines we drink after a meal. And wines we can drink anytime. The wines we drink before a meal are called aperitif, or appetizer wines. They cleanse our palate and wake up our taste buds. They get us ready to eat. They're dry, with as little sugar as possible, because sugar dulls the appetite. Aperitif wines are short, crisp drinks, mostly served with hors d'oeuvres as a pre-dinner drink. Perhaps the most magnificent aperitif wine is a first-class champagne, but the most popular ones are sherry and vermouth. Sherry is astringent. It quickly cleans the palate. Vermouth is wine that's been infused with spices and herbs to make it a pleasant and stimulating aperitif. Wines we drink with food or a meal are called table wines. They're called white or red, depending on the type of grape that they're made from. They can be dry or sweet wines. White wines are more delicate than reds. There are two basic white wine styles, acid and soft. The acid wines are dry and firm. They're the Rieslings, the Hocks, the Chablis, or sometimes they're named after a grape variety such as Rhine Riesling. They're very crisp and fresh and go beautifully with oysters and shellfish or fish. The softer styles of white wines are called white Burgundies, or after grape varieties such as Semillon or Trebbiano. For the soft wines, the grapes are picked later. As the grapes ripen, the sugar content rises and makes a wine with less acid. The soft wines taste big and round. They're wonderful wines to serve with dishes like veal or poultry. The sweet white table wines, the Sauternes or the Spätlis Rieslings, are made to go with fruit and desserts. Red table wines are usually stronger than whites. They go with richer, more strongly flavored foods. They're the Clarets and the Burgundies, or they're named after the grapes that they were made from, such as Hermitage or Cabernet. The dry reds, or Clarets, are a firm style of wine. What we'd call an acid style in white wine. They're quite astringent and quite gripping to taste. These firm reds are wonderful with steak and grills. As food gets richer, so should the wine, so that the flavor of the wine is not dominated by the flavor of the food. The rounder, softer reds like Burgundy go best with rich dishes like casseroles and stews or roasts. There are no hard or fast rules for the wines we drink with our meals. Some wines go better with some dishes than others. But the right one always is the one that you like most. The wines made to drink after the main meal are called dessert wines. They have the opposite effect to aperitif wines. If aperitif wines stimulate our appetite, dessert wines satisfy it and leave us contented and happy. There's no nicer way to end a meal than a glass of velvet smooth port, or an almost liqueur like Muscat. There are many people who say once you've drunk a good Australian Muscat, you'll never drink a liqueur again. And it's easy to find one. Almost every Australian winemaker makes a superb Muscat. Then there are the wines that we can drink at any time. Sparkling wines, they're wonderful with food to celebrate with, or to just plain enjoy. Rosé is a beautiful light wine that goes beautifully with our warm climate. Sherry is more than just an aperitif. It's a nice drink when you feel like a drink, but only a little drink. And any cold white makes a great thirst quencher anytime. And then there's champagne. It goes well before, with, or after a meal. It's a beautiful way to begin an evening, or to end an evening. What is the secret that makes champagne so beautifully romantic? The million tiny bubbles that tingle with happiness and a winemaker's skill. To begin with, it's made in the same way as white wine. But instead of the young wine being bottled straight away, a mixture of cane sugar syrup and yeast is added to the wine. It's then bottled and sealed and left so a second fermentation can take place. The carbon dioxide that is formed in this second fermentation can't escape, and it's married into the wine to become the bubbles in champagne. The long time that the wine spends on the lees, the yeast cells in the bottle, is what gives champagne its unique flavor. After the maturation is complete, the yeast cells in the wine are shaken down into the neck of the bottle. Then the bottle is opened and the solids are forced out by great pressure. The bottles are topped up with a bottle from the same vintage, recorked and wired. It's a long and costly process. But now we have champagne. The first grapevines came to Australia in 1788. Since then, they've prospered in many places, like the beautiful Barossa Valley just north of Adelaide, where the early German migrants planted their vines. They not only made wine, they made beautiful little towns and churches. Today, the Barossa Valley is full of their descendants, still making wine. Grapevines still grow within sight of the city of Adelaide, where some of the earliest plantings were. Just south of Adelaide, there are the Southern District's vineyards at Raynella and McLaren Vale. And in the far southeastern corner of South Australia is Coonawarra. If we follow the Murray River upstream, we'll find vineyards all along the way. At Wakery, Loxton, Berry, and Renmark in South Australia. And from Mildura and Robinvale to Swan Hill and further on at Rutherglen and Corowa. The other Victorian vineyards are at Tobilk in the Goulburn Valley and at Great Western. In Western Australia, grapes are grown in the Swan Valley near Perth. In New South Wales, there are vineyards in the Riverina at Griffith, Hanwood, Yenda, and Leeton. There are vineyards at Forbes, at Mudgee, and in the Hunter Valley. Grapes are grown almost everywhere the climate and soil is right for them. They're grown by big companies and cooperative growers and small families. Big or small, they'll all invite you to visit their vineyards to taste their wine and learn more about wine and winemaking. And at festival time, they'll invite you to become part of the wonderful world of wine. Welcome to the wonderful world of Australian wine.